Welcome back to Austin. We are with Zach Lamplugh and Brian Emond. Did I say the last names right?
Yeah.
Lamplugh?
Right.
Emond, you got it.
Emond, yeah. Yes, I got it. And we were talking about your feature film, The Vice Guide to Bigfoot. Mm-hmm. I can talk this morning. It's fine. Okay, so first thing I have to ask, how did you even get away with this? Because half the movie, I was like, this has got to be like an actual Vice thing, right? Because they wouldn't let them do it if it...
How'd we get away with it?
Yes, how'd you get away with it?
We didn't. We're currently still getting away with it.
Oh, okay. We will not tell anyone.
I mean, if they hear about it, it's okay. We're just...
No, stop recording this. We have to stop. We just made it.
Okay, so I saw a thing in your press notes, like, it's like the same equipment and you're like borrowing crew from them. Like, what happened? How did that work?
So our producer, we didn't really borrow crew, I guess. Our producer had shot some things with them before.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when they roll into town, they're like, they don't bring all their stuff on the plane all the time. They're a production company, so they like find local people with camera rentals and sound equipment and whatever. And he had already outfitted a bunch of stuff with Vice shoots before. And so he was the guy who helped us produce the movie. And he was just like, yeah, like, oh, you want it to look like Vice? Yeah, whenever they come in, they like rent my stuff and they like use my stuff. So you can just use the same stuff. And so he's like putting the camera package together for us. And he was like, yeah, this is pretty much exactly what we would use for Vice. So just take it.
Nice.
Whenever he would be off on his own, our producer would be spinning the camera around. It looks like he was just like filming a bush or like filming the ground, but in a cool way. And I was like, what are you doing? And he's like, trust me, it looks amazing. And all of those shots made it into the film. Yeah. Like every single, just someone racking focus on a tree or something like that. It's like, wow, it looks really Vice-like.
Yeah,
it's
great. Yeah.
It's
really like we were spoofing not just Vice, but also just like this millennial style of documentary
extremely
shooting.
Extremely serious, serious.
Yeah, and all the just like crazy B-roll, just like close-ups of somebody's like hand or just a bunch of BS. And so I had shot some things like that too before, and so we were just like, let's just treat this movie as if we were like day players on a freaking BuzzFeed documentary.
Yes.
So yeah.
Well, no, like so much of it was just like right up my alley, because I mean like that thing just like moved.
Oops. Oh well,
the Sasquatch is moving in the walls.
Yeah, right.
But so much, I was like, just like the super dry humor that's totally, totally my brand. And then the whole, like, you know, the young journalist trying so hard to be taken seriously and do serious work. I was like, yep.
Yeah.
Every bit of it.
That's like a theme that I always wanted to incorporate, because like a lot of our friends are like that. Like everybody has a passion and everybody has a day job. You know what I mean? And and very rarely do you get to make your passion your day job. And a lot of people do work somewhere cool and feel like it's not creatively fulfilling them. It's like this weird, like you get to work in the same building as your dreams. You know what I mean? So, and a lot of my friends are like that. So I was just like, no one's ever really addressed that. And I think a lot of people, we also like started making this. We started like kind of making fun of Vice in like some previous sketches and stuff back in like 2017, and then we made the movie in like 2018. And I don't know. I guess I feel like a lot of my friends were also too scared to make fun of Vice, because there's this thing where they just don't want to slam Vice.
Yeah, you don't want to like.
But I really want to work somewhere cool, dude.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So we were just like, whatever. Who cares? Let's just burn this bridge we don't even have. So, yeah.
No, I love the horror comedy genre too. Like Shaun of the Dead is one of my absolute favorite movies. So I love that brand of humor, a mix of humor and a little bit of the spookiness.
Yeah.
But I caught a lot of film references in there. Like there's obviously a Jurassic Park reference and Deliverance. But I remember with the Ma Pritchard character, I was like, is that like White Heat? Like the Ma Jarrett character is like this really creepy mom.
No, it was more like that lady from Justified. Have you seen Justified?
I was thinking of Animal Kingdom.
Oh yeah.
The mom that runs the whole gang.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
Of course, Animal Kingdom is like super serious. Or Peaky Blinders, even the ant that runs the crew.
We knew Virginia, who was our actress, and she's like a really great actress, and so we were like, let's just make it like about her. Like, she could, she's got like the dramatic chops to pull that off.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we were like, yeah, let's like use her for it.
Like the day of the shoot, actually, for her last scene, she had like a really long monologue,
mm-hmm.
and just at the last minute, we were like, we do not like this monologue, and we changed it completely. She had memorized it already, and then she just goes, okay, and then just picked up the script like as she's almost about to walk on,
mm-hmm.
and then just reads it all, and she goes, okay, I got it. And then did what you saw in the film.
Like you do.
Yeah. So, mm-hmm. it's great to have someone like that. Like, it's easy to be like, oh, well, the character kind of writes itself because she's going to kill it.
Yeah.
No, I love the dramatic irony of that. The scene that I'm presuming you're referring to, it's because you're not good at wit.
You're not good
at your profession. I was like, that is like every millennial's ultimate, like deep ultimate fear right there. It's like, I'm not any good.
Yeah,
I'm just terrible at this.
Yeah.
Okay, I do have to ask, this is random. Those glasses were not real. You're not wearing any glasses.
He doesn't need glasses.
I knew it. I knew it. I was like, the whole time I was like, no, he's doing that thing that I do sometimes. Not usually, but sometimes. Like, I've got my computer glasses, like my blue light glasses for migraines. But if I just want to like look cool and really smart, then I'll just keep them on, even though
it's
need the glasses. And I was like, he's doing the same thing. Those are just frames. There's not even glasses in there.
Yeah, we actually, the character really does, I guess, have glasses. We just realized early on that it reflects. So we were just like, oh, you're going to see the crew on every single shot if we use real glasses.
Yeah.
So those got to go. And that was that decision.
Yeah, I was kind of like, no, not real. And so I've been waiting all morning. I'm like, I'm going to see if those glasses are real. I'm going to see if he actually needs glasses.
At one point, we considered doing a scene addressing that, where we were like, so is he a guy who wears fake glasses?
Yes.
And we decided that it's just too unlikable for the main character to be like, by the way, I'm additionally fake in even more ways.
Yes.
Like, it was just too much for one guy to be this shitty and then follow him for an hour and a half.
All right, so how much crew did you actually have with you running around in the woods?
It varied on day to day. Like there were some days where it was like very few people, and then there were some days where it was like up to like 20 people, like maybe 10 crew and 10 extras or things like that. So
yeah, there was a lot of cast out there on some parts.
Yeah, it really just like it shrank and grew depending on like what we were doing, and there was like a couple days we actually had a day off. Get this, yeah. So, like, day, like, 6 or 7, there was a day where, like, just the crew couldn't come out. Mm-hmm. Like, everybody, there was too many obligations, and we were supposed to have a day off. But I still took them out in the woods anyway, and we just did, like, B-roll day.
Mm-hmm.
We did B-roll day and got a couple other shots. And, like... So anyway, even on our days off, I was making them work.
Did you get any, did you stick pretty close to your script except for abandoning the monologue that day? Or was there some improv in the works?
It was pretty heavy on the script. Mm-hmm. Like, I would say it sometimes feels pretty loose, but it was pretty heavily scripted, especially since we didn't have a lot of, like, it had to be exactly as we thought it would be so that we could edit and get it done on time.
Sure.
Like, there wasn't a lot of, like, well, we'll just shoot 5 hours of footage and we'll just
run into.
Yeah, and see what, and just cut it down. So a lot of it, but I would say of all the people, Jeff, we have a long-standing relationship working with him, and we really trust him, and he's just hilarious. So a lot of scenes, we wrote the lines for him, and we were like, also, you can also kind of say whatever you want here.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you feel something different, go with that, because we definitely want that instead.
Yeah, how much of that character is just, he's kind of like, they're going to walk in and be shocked at what I've done to their script. You know, like, how much of that is just him bringing that personality and that... that different taste to the character, and how much is like, so he's wearing a puffy jacket and an Indiana Jones hat, like.
I bought like 3 hats, and it was like, I shipped them to his house actually, and I was like, you decide whatever fits you best, man. And then like, as far as the outfit and everything, yeah, we'd like selected an outfit. There wasn't like a lot of times where like we would turn the camera on and he's like, I had a totally different idea. So to your question earlier, like, most of the people in this went to like acting conservatories, actually.
Yeah.
So they're very good at making this feel like it's improvisational, but we had like a script and everything. But also, I directed it, and I wasn't going to like nitpick everything that came out of their mouths. You know what I mean? Like, if somebody has a riff on something, I'm not going to be like, no, do it exactly the way it's said. So. Mm-hmm. we had like every scene we knew what was going to happen.
Yeah.
And, but like some things, like the part where he keeps asking Jeff about hey, so was your relationship torn apart by Big? And he keeps telling him, shh, they just made that up. Like, we just had an extra 10 minutes, and I was, like, messing with the camera, like, trying to get something to work. And then when I went back to them, they were like, we have a really funny idea. Can we just, like, take 10 minutes and do this? And then it was, like, the funniest gag in that whole thing. Yeah.
I'm kind of wondering, I mean, obviously Vice is the big inspiration here, but there were a couple points I picked up. I was like, this is, like, the whole... It's the young YouTubers that are trying to be edgy, like finding the body in the woods. I was like, oh, it's a Logan Paul reference where like the horrible, not funny thing happened. But okay, so how much of it was inspired by like that new media, like social media influencers, YouTubers, you know, iPhone videographers?
I mean, that main character a fair amount. Mm-hmm. I mean, especially like when it gets desperate, that's sort of like views at all costs, the like get eyes on me for at any cost.
Whatever we have to do.
Yeah, and you sort of, that's, I mean, I think when the character loses himself and like we as people also like lose it when it's just like, I gotta get what I want. I gotta get to my dream.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I think that's what Logan Paul does too.
Yeah. I think though we were less spoofing like YouTube famous. I mean, like we kind of, well, that one guy runs a YouTube channel in there.
Yeah.
So we were kind of spoofing the like loud YouTube, like, hey, what's up subscribers?
Hey,
like
guys.
A little bit, but more we were spoofing like the people that I know that are like 30 something professionals that are just like way too chill to be like interviewing this famous boxer right now. Ugh. You know, like, yeah,
I know those people too.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe I'm one of those people. I don't know.
No, you have more personality.
If you were here, that is a relief.
If you were here, you're just like, so I'm here with the creators of a movie.
So guys,
yeah.
I haven't watched it yet.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really do movies. I mostly do books.
Yeah.
So when this goes to print, let me know.
I read this book yesterday. You probably haven't heard of it.
Yeah.
Okay, well, guys, this is such like a perfect Austin movie, so I'm really, really glad that you brought it to town, and I hope we see you again. And I would love for this to be like a horror series. Like, I don't know what's gonna follow up Bigfoot, but you need to find it and bring it.
I know, we need to figure out something next.
Bring it to the people.
Yeah, we have a few ideas.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. Glad to hear it. Well, congratulations. There it goes.
Oh, no.
Perfect.
Oh well.
The Vice Guide to Bigfoot.
Vice Guide to Bigfoot.
Yeah.
See it today.
Completely intentional.
Perfect.